Good morning, everyone. My name is Maria, and it's a great pleasure to welcome you to our online service this morning. As we come together this morning in our many and different homes, let us come before the God of the universe. Let us come before Jesus, our Saviour and Lord and friend, and let us worship. Let's sing together, "Come, now is the time to worship." Jesus said to them, "Who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Let us pray together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. O God, fount of all wisdom, in the humble witness of the Apostle Peter, you have shown the foundation of our faith. Give us the light of your Spirit, that recognizing in Jesus of Nazareth, the Son of the living God, we may be living stones for the building up of your holy church. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever. Amen.
Jesus, come into the land, pour out the love.
our series on the book of Acts. And as we look at God's word this morning, I encourage you, if you have a Bible at home, to get it out and read along.
Our reading this morning is Acts chapter 4. The priests and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people, proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. They seized Peter and John, and because it was evening, they put them in jail until the next day. But many who heard the message believed, so the number of men who believed grew to about 5,000. The next day, the rulers, the elders, and the teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. Annas, the high priest, was there, and so were Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and others of the high priest's family. They had Peter and John brought before them and began to question them. "By what power or what name did you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame, and are being asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, but there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved." When they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished, and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. But since they could see the man who had been healed standing there with them, there was nothing they could say. So they ordered them to withdraw from the Sanhedrin and then conferred together. "What are we going to do with these men?" they asked. "Everyone living in Jerusalem knows they have performed a notable sign, and we cannot deny it. But to stop this thing from spreading any further among the people, we must warn them to speak no longer to anyone in this name." Then they called them in again and commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, "Which is right in God's eyes, to listen to you or to him? You be the judges. As for us, we cannot help speaking about what we have seen and heard." After further threats, they let them go. They could not decide how to punish them because all the people were praising God for what had happened. For the man who was miraculously healed was over 40 years old. On their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. When they heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer to God. "Sovereign Lord," they said, "you made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them. You spoke by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of your servant, our father David. Why did the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth rise up and the rulers band together against the Lord and against his anointed one. Indeed, Herod and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in the city to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant Jesus." After they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. All the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them, All that were there were no needy persons among them. From time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them, brought the money from the sales, and put it all at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to anyone who had need. Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, whom the apostles called Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, sold a field he owned and brought the money and put it at the apostles' feet. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to
God. The Gospel of Matthew, chapter 16, beginning at the 13th verse. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you,
Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, many years ago, when I was a young theological student, so yes, many, 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 many years ago, a friend of mine who was also studying theology at the time and went to the same church as me, stood up the front to lead the prayers on a Sunday. And he did something which really stood out as quite unusual and led to quite a few shocked faces, people opening their eyes in the middle of the prayers as if to say, "Did he actually pray that?" He stood up there and he prayed that we would experience persecution. Well, I'm not sure if you've ever heard somebody pray that the church would experience persecution, and I wonder whether you would have been one of those people opening their eyes and saying, "What did you just say?" What had happened was that he and I had both been studying church history, and we'd been reading about the way in which the church actually grew and prospered during times of intense persecution. Now, I'm not sure that I would have done quite the same and actually prayed for persecution, but I can see where he was coming from. And I think that's exactly what we see in our reading today from the book of Acts, that even in the face of persecution, the good news of Jesus triumphs. The Spirit is at work. There is great fruit that comes during this time of persecution. Well, Judith read beautifully for us chapter 4, which was a long enough reading, so I didn't ask her to read chapter 3 as well. But chapters 3 and 4 are a package. They go together. So I'm going to go back a little bit, if you've got your Bible with you, and give you a bit of that background from chapter 3. Peter and John were going to pray at the Jewish temple, and they meet a lame beggar. This beggar had been hanging out there at the temple for a very long time. But on this occasion, things turn out quite differently for him. Peter says to him, "In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." And the man is healed. Then he went on, verse 8, with them into the temple courts, walking, jumping, praising God. And when all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as that same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. Luke tells us not just about the miracle that happened, but the reaction of the wider crowd. And he shows us the way in which this miracle actually becomes a teaching opportunity. And Peter explains that the healing came from Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And he goes on and he gives another evangelistic talk, just like we saw last week. He uses scripture to tell the gospel and share with people the fulfillment of God's promises in the resurrected Jesus. And the passage that we heard today, chapter 4, is the results of all this. For we see that in contrast to the faithful response of the beggar, not everybody responded with repentance and belief. In this chapter, in chapter 4, Luke introduces us to persecution, the persecution that soon arose in the face of the apostles' ministry. But of course, this persecution wasn't new, and it was to be expected, because it was the same persecution that Jesus himself faced, that led to his crucifixion, and that he promised would befall all those who likewise take up their cross and follow him. Well, verse 1, the priests there and the Sadducees, they're greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people, proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. You might remember, if you've read through the Gospels before, that the Sadducees are known for refusing to believe in the end time resurrection. Well, here they are, greatly disturbed because the apostles are proclaiming Jesus, the resurrection. Jesus, the resurrection for all, the resurrection of the dead. So there's several responses that we're seeing so far in Acts. There's the repentance and belief. There's the awe, the amazement, the wonder. Not quite believing in Jesus as our resurrected Lord, but really intrigued. What's going on here? And then we have those who were greatly disturbed. And the result of this last reaction to the ministry is that the leaders have Peter and John arrested and put in jail overnight. But what's really interesting in this retelling of these events is that Luke, as he writes this for us, instead of focusing on the persecution, instead of focusing on that night in prison, he seems to use this moment in history as a way to explain the success and the fruitfulness of their ministry. Verse 4, if you have a look there, but many who heard the message believed. So the number of men who believed grew to about 5,000. We see here the progress of the gospel in the face of opposition. The next day, in verse 5, Peter and John are brought before the Sanhedrin. The rulers, the elders, the teachers of the law, the bigwigs are there. Once again, Peter, verse 8, is filled with the Spirit. Once again, he uses this as another gospel-telling opportunity. Another evangelistic gospel presentation is made as he shares with people the good news of Jesus. The Jewish rulers were worried with good reason. They can see the effect that this preaching of the good news is having. And so they command them, verse 18, not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. What do Peter and John say? What? We can't help speaking about what we have seen and heard. Well, all the people are praising God for what has happened. With this sort of persecution, you might have thought, well, looks like it's all going to take a rather nasty turn. Jesus has given this tremendous commission. They're to go to the ends of the earth, filled with the Spirit's power, and share the good news. But here we are in chapter 4. Maybe not. Maybe this is all just a bit too dangerous. Will the gospel, in fact, make it out towards the ends of the earth? At this stage, Perhaps we won't make it out of Jerusalem. But no, it's in the face of this persecution that the apostles seem to be even stronger. And we're told about the way that their witness continues and the way that it continues to bear fruit. And in light of the way that people are praising God, they end up letting them go, thinking, oh, how are we going to quell this? And it's the next part of this story, the way the believers respond as Peter and John go back and tell them about what has happened, that I think has particular relevance for us as a church community today. Now, who loves Winnie the Pooh? Never too old for a bit of Winnie the Pooh, are you? I wonder if you have read the story where Pooh and Piglet go hunting and nearly catch a woozle. The suspense builds in this story as they imagine this woozle creature and how scary and dangerous he is. And of course, they don't realize that they're actually trekking around and around in the same circle around a tree. So they're looking at all the footprints and they're like, oh, now there are four woozles chasing after us. What are we going to do? Things are getting quite scary. And when things get to that point where it's looking, you know, it's looking very grim indeed, Piglet has the most adorable little response. He licks the tip of his nose, finds that brings very little comfort, and then he says, I think that I have just remembered something. I have just remembered something that I forgot to do yesterday, and I shan't be able to do it tomorrow. I suppose I really ought to go back home right now and do it now. Well, you can do it in the afternoon and I'll come with you, says Pooh. Well, says Piglet, it's actually not the sort of thing you can do in an afternoon. It's a particular morning sort of thing that I need to do. And it needs to be done, if possible, between the hours of... What time would you say it is, Pooh? Ah, says Pooh, looking at the sun. I'd say it's about 12. Well, it is the particular sort of thing that has to be done between the hours of 12 and 12:05, said Piglet. So, my dear old Pooh, if you'll just excuse me, I'd better go off and do this very, very important thing. Ta-ta, says Piglet. I'm out of here. He is even happier when he sees good old Christopher Robin coming. He knows that Pooh will be okay. He's not going to risk sticking around for the woozle. Well, I don't know about you, but if I was an early believer back in the beginning times of the church that we're reading about now in Acts, I can imagine a lot of people having a Piglet moment right about now. Oh, I've just remembered something exceptionally important that needs to get done. I'll just leave you here with the whole getting thrown in prison and getting in huge trouble for sharing the gospel thing, and you go on doing that good work. See you later. But we don't see that at all, do we? It's quite astounding. They don't make excuses and they don't run away. And when Peter and John go back and report verse 22, instead of everybody saying, oh, what was it like in prison? Was it terribly scary? You know, you poor things. Instead, verse 24, their first reaction is to raise their voices together in prayer. And what do they pray? That they'd be protected, that they'd be safe, that they wouldn't end up back in prison, that more people wouldn't go to prison? No. Instead, first they praise God for his power. Believers show how they understand that God is in control even now. They know from the scriptures that God is sovereign. They remember the persecution of Jesus. They know, verse 28, that even this that's happening now is not happening outside of God's sovereign will. And they're being treated like Jesus. What a privilege. What an honor to follow in the footsteps of their Lord and Savior, Jesus. They remember Jesus facing the Sanhedrin and being unfairly accused. They remember Jesus teaching his disciples that following him would mean they would have to carry their cross. They would experience likewise persecution. And so they pray, verse 29, that they might be enabled to speak God's word with boldness. They pray for God to work miraculously in the name of the risen Lord Jesus. And God hears their prayer and answers their prayer. Through the power of the Spirit, we read, they speak the word of God boldly. There's an earthquake, which in the Old Testament often show the presence and power of God there with them. In the face of persecution and opposition, they are not alone. God hears and answers their prayer. Their response isn't to fear, it's not to hide, it's not to stop, but to pray for boldness. And the gospel keeps bearing fruit. We're told in verse 33, with great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. When Jesus was persecuted, when he was nailed to a tree, it looked like it was over. It looked like it was the end. And yet in that moment, God triumphs ultimately, defeating sin and death, and Jesus rises again, offering new life to all who trust in him. And here in Acts, again we see this great moment of persecution, and yet in this moment, God triumphs once again. Many come to faith. In these chapters from Acts, we see this bold proclamation of the good news of Jesus. We see that it doesn't just come from something within the disciples, the apostles themselves. It comes from the supernatural power of the Spirit that Jesus promised. And we see the fruit of this. We see the dynamic growth of the church. So many people coming to believe in Jesus, to trust in him. Well, what about today? I wonder if you knew that today in 2020, Christians are the most persecuted people group in the world. And yet, the gospel is still bearing fruit all over the world. Do you pray that the gospel would bear fruit? Are we praying for those who are persecuted for their faith, that they would be bold, that they would be courageous, that their proclamation of God's word would bear fruit? We don't just have to look around the world to see opposition to the good news. I'm sure if we consider our own personal lives, there are many obstacles, many things that might discourage us, that might cause us to have a piglet moment and remember something very important, something else that needs to be done. I'm so encouraged when I read the book of Acts that it's not all just on us. Jesus promised the Spirit, and it was through the Spirit's power that the apostles could be bold, that they could share the good news. What an encouragement for us today when we're not feeling particularly bold, when we're not quite sure of what to say or what to do in a particular situation. To know that we too can pray that the Spirit will show us what to do or what to say. I love hearing people's testimony of how they came to faith. And I'll always remember a friend telling me many years ago her unique story of how she became a follower of Jesus. She told me how many years ago she was not just not a Christian, she was completely anti these Christian people that she called them. So much so that when her neighbour who she knew was a Christian, offered to carpool and take her children to school for her. She said no, it would have been incredibly useful, but she did not want her kids getting in the car with this Christian lady, being indoctrinated, perhaps catching this terrible ridiculousness off her, so she said no. But this neighbour, this friend of hers, she didn't let that stop her. She continued to be a great friend. And when this lady actually became a single mum, when her husband left her and she was on her own with a tribe of kids and doing it tough, it was this neighbour that stuck by her. Didn't matter how many times she said, no, I'm fine, I don't need your help. This neighbour kept offering help, kept offering friendship, kept offering food or meals or lifts, whatever she could do to help. And what she didn't know at the time was that this neighbour was also offering prayer. This neighbour was constantly praying that she would come to know Jesus. Well, this neighbour eventually gave her a Bible, and one night she opened that Bible and she read the Gospel of John. And that night she became a Christian. She put her trust in Jesus. It's an amazing story, isn't it? She went from being someone that was so worried about Christians, she didn't even want her kids to go in the same car as a Christian, to opening God's word, reading the good news of Jesus, and deciding she wanted to be a follower of Jesus. Maybe you can relate to that lady who became a Christian. Or maybe you can relate to the neighbour that kept persevering. I think it's really normal to feel hesitant about sharing your faith. People always ask me questions because of my job, because I'm a minister. Sometimes I'll go to get my hair cut and they'll say, so what do you do? And I'll think, oh, if I tell them the truth, I know they're going to have questions and I'll have to answer them. But it's amazing the way that if I pray, God not only gives me opportunities, but he helps me to know what to say. Now, don't get me wrong, that doesn't mean that there aren't so many times where I feel stupid or I feel awkward or I think later in retrospect, oh, why didn't I say that or why didn't I do that? The amazing thing is that we're not on our own. It doesn't matter if we feel like we've made a mistake or we've mucked up a situation. It's a team effort, and it's not in our power. It's through the gift of the Holy Spirit that we're able to be part of this incredible ministry of sharing Jesus with others. So I really want to encourage you, if sometimes you feel a bit overwhelmed or out of your depth, pray. Pray that God would show you the way to live and speak his loving kindness into the lives of others. Is there somebody that you would just love to come to know Jesus? Family member, a friend, a neighbor? Keep praying for them. Maybe it will happen in 10 days, and maybe it will happen in 10 years. And maybe it will happen in 99 years. I've had the privilege of sitting at the bedside of people in their 90s that decide, I want to become a follower of Jesus. There's definitely no age limit. Who will you be praying for this week? Maybe you'll just play a small role in a chain of all sorts of things that God is doing in that person's life. But what a privilege to be part of that chain. Will you pray for those that are persecuted, that they will be bold? I will be praying for you, and I hope that you might pray for me too, that we would be bold and that we would make the most of every opportunity. The good news of Jesus is life-changing. Let's share it together as a community.
some time praying together this morning. Father, Son, and Spirit, we come before you this morning in prayer, acknowledging your great love and mercy that give us life and hope. Jesus, we thank you for being our cornerstone, our foundation. Even though you were rejected by those in authority and put to death, death was not enough to hold you down. We marvel again at the glory we find in you, that we can have life to the full because of you. We thank you for offering us this gift of salvation, found in no other name. Thank you for using us as part of your plan to share this good news with the nations. Embolden us to share this good news with those around us. Thank you that we do this together. Give us creativity to know how to do this, particularly at this time with restrictions in place, and when we do not know how long this will continue. Lord God, help us to be your light in the world. Father God, we bring you our world, our country, and our city as we struggle on with the day-to-day life of COVID. Some struggle with not enough to eat, with no shelter, some with loneliness, some with mental health worries, some with physical health, some with financial hardship, no work, or underemployment. Please continue to provide for those in need. Please use us to help answer those needs however we can. Let us and our actions serve as a light that reflects you at this time. Let us also be willing to ask for help when we need it. We know that this is a particularly difficult time for those in leadership in our country, and we uphold our political leaders to you, Lord. They need your wisdom, love, strength, and care at this time. Let us show them grace, as we also would like grace to be shown to us. Heavenly Father, we continue to pray that you would help us at this time to be a community that will shine your light in the world. We pray for those in our community who need your extra care, love, and comfort at this time, and we name them in our hearts now. We also pray for those we know who are celebrating birthdays and anniversaries this week, and we pray your blessing on them. We thank you, Jesus, that you hear our prayer, and we conclude this time of prayer by saying together the prayer that you taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Let us therefore bring our sins before the one true God, in penitence and faith, confident that he forgives us. Let's pray together. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, we are assured of our forgiveness because of Christ and his death and resurrection. And so we hear these wonderful words. Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from all your sins, strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we share the peace that we have with God with each other as well. We are the body of Christ. His Spirit is with us. The peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you. Well, this morning there's just a few notices to share. So the first that I'd like to share with you this morning is that you're welcome to check out our website, mullumanglican.org.au. There's information there about the things that go on here regularly. Many of those things are online at the moment, so please do send us an email if you'd like more information. We have a weekly email that goes out on a Friday that's got lots of information about the day-to-day things that are going on. The Alpha course that is happening at the moment is happening on a Sunday afternoon at 5 o'clock. You're very welcome to join in, even if you haven't been to the first couple. Now is a great time to get involved, and particularly if you are asking questions about who is Jesus and why did he die. These are great things that we talk about at Alpha. So please do get in contact with us, and you can find those details on our website. Well, Mullum Mullum Kids Church has happened. It is happening. It's happened this morning. We love it. We have a lot of fun playing games together over Zoom at 9:30 in the morning. And then we watch our YouTube Kids Church. If you haven't got involved yet and you'd like to, you're welcome to come and join us. You can find the details for that in the Friday email. But you're also welcome to watch the YouTube video, even if you don't have small children. It's super fun, and it's sort of like a little summary of what happens in our big church, because we're following the same Acts series that the sermons are. So, Mullum Mullum Kids Church, it's good times. We are so grateful for how many people get involved each week here. We're super grateful for how many people have contributed to the food parcels that we've been handing out. We'll try and take a picture of all these amazing bags. Right now, they're directly in my line of vision, and they're all sorted beautifully, ready to go. We're just so grateful for how generous all of you are, and it just shows how much of a heart we have to serve our local community. If you're looking for a way to get involved in some of the things that happen here, there's some particular need around our technical team, putting together our services, and also our pastoral care team. Just giving people a call, having a chat, seeing how they're going. If you're interested in either of those things, please do get in touch with myself or Maria. We'd love to hear from you. We are particularly grateful for your ongoing financial partnership as we continue to serve our community here. And so I'm gonna pray and just thank you as we continue our service. So let me pray. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have these gifts to share. Accept and use our offerings given throughout the week for your glory and for the service of your kingdom. Blessed be God forever. Well, we're here to gather together and share in communion this morning. So we invite you to pray with us and to break bread in your home. Let's pray. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Loving God, we thank you for this world of wonder and delight. You have given it to us to care for so that all your creatures may enjoy its bounty. Lord our God, we give you thanks and praise. We thank you that when we turned away from you, you sent Jesus to live and work as one of us and bring us back to you. He showed us how to love you and set us free to love and serve one another. Lord our God, we give you thanks and praise. We thank you that on the cross Jesus took away our sin, all that keeps us from each other and from you. He frees us from hate and fear, from all that destroys love and trust. Lord our God, we give you thanks and praise. And so with everyone who believes in you, with all the saints and angels, we rejoice and praise you, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. And now we thank you for these gifts of bread and wine. May we who receive them, as Jesus said, share his body and his blood. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and gave you thanks. He broke the bread and gave it to his friends and said, Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks.
He shared the cup with them and said, "This is my blood poured out so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in remembrance of me." Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Fill us with your Spirit, that we may follow Jesus in all we do and say, working for justice and bringing your peace to this world that you have made. Accept our prayers through Jesus Christ our Lord. Blessing and honour and glory and power are yours forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We who are many are one body, for we all share in the one bread. May the body of Christ keep you in eternal life. May the blood of Christ keep you in eternal life.
Thank you.
May the power of your love, which we have known in word and sacrament, continue your saving work among us. Give us courage for our pilgrimage and bring us to the joys you promise. Most loving God, you send us into the world you love. Give us grace to go thankfully and with courage in the power of your Spirit. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. Well, we pray that you have a wonderful week, and we look forward to joining you for other things this week that you might like to get involved in, like Alpha, and we'll see you again next week. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen.